Howdy folks, it's Glenn with the Cactus Atlas, and I'm going to take you on a little mini road trip adventure in one of Arizona's most beautiful sections of road, Route 89A, at the base of the Vermilion Cliffs. And we're going to explore the hell out of it. So consider this maybe lesser known fact. If you live in the Phoenix area like I do, it takes about 5.5 hours to drive to the north rim of the Grand Canyon, but it only takes about 3.5 hours to drive to the south rim of the Grand Canyon, and the two rims are only miles apart. Why is that, do you say? So you have this thing in the way called the Colorado River, the thing that formed the Grand Canyon, in fact. So there are only, I think, about 7 crossings within 750 miles of each other. So it's very sparse crossing, and back in the day, before what I am about to show you was built, people would have to drive 800 miles to get like from Arizona to Utah and circumvent the canyon depending on their approach. So put that in perspective. You'll also learn on a different episode that we're doing on Lee's Ferry prior to the bridge in the area that I'm about to show you. The only way across were across a ferry in one specific spot along the Colorado. So imagine in the 1920s when cars were more common and people were starting to want to drive and travel more, you needed a better way to get across. So enter the historic Navajo Bridge and its more modern companion. Bridges that are built hundreds of feet above the Colorado River below. And there's your more modern bridge on the other side. You're gonna easily have, I think, 2 lanes of traffic with large things being towed like that. Today, I don't think you'd be able to fit side by side on something this narrow. So here we go. This newer bridge was dedicated in 1995. There's some pictures of it being constructed. And the newer bridge. This is actually giving me the woogies a little bit. You know, standing on an almost 100-year-old bridge looking at the Colorado from hundreds of feet high. And that other bridge really kind of adds to the vertigo. It just, you know, helps you see the scales a little bit more maybe. But, my neck is tingling. I don't know why, I have problems sometimes. I don't know what's considered the center of the bridge, or we'll just have to like eyeball it, but let's look this other way towards Lee's Ferry. And holy moly, so I'm over the water for sure. And I don't know if you could see it here, but the Colorado runs pretty clear, but you could see lots of silt and mud. It looks like someone like dashed a little bit of like cream in their coffee kind of look. But beautiful reflections off the Colorado. If you don't care about the history of the bridge, you've come here for the picture moment, the picture opportunity of a lifetime here. And you know, look at that. It's the later afternoon now, so the shadows are starting to come out. The colors are starting to pop more. It's a fantastic time of day to be out here near the Vermilion Cliffs. On my channel, and it's recorded and in words forever, I've often said Utah is in the lead for my favorite state for natural beauty, and I still think that's true. But then I come to this part of Arizona, and every time I do, I discover new things, and I am almost starting to feel there's some stiffer competition as I explore the northern reaches of Arizona more. And because you all know that I'm a completionist, I absolutely have to do this and go all the way across, and then we'll actually look at the bridges from this side, and then we'll go back over to the other side. And this is one of the best views in Arizona, I gotta say. You just get like a natural free overlook of epic proportions on a historical bridge next to some of the most beautiful cliffs in existence. I'd still need to tease out their color and get them out of that late afternoon haze, but we'll get to that. Right, the Navajo Bridge. That was cool. That was my first time, by the way. I've never seen that before. I've driven over it several times in my life, but never stopped, which is a pity. So if you're ever going this way between, you know, maybe Phoenix and Kanab, or you're heading to the north rim of the Grand Canyon from the south, you're gonna drive over this thing if you're coming this way, so do yourself a favor and stop. So if you're heading this direction, going towards Kanab, here on 89A in Arizona, right after you cross the bridge, you're gonna see a sign for Lee's Ferry. And I highly recommend, at the very least, you do yourself a favor if you're just touring around, and just drive down the road for a little bit. And I'm gonna show you why. In the state of Arizona, this little road here that goes back here, I think, is one of the prettiest drives in the state. It's pretty short, and it heads over to Lee's Ferry, a historic river crossing over the Colorado River. And the Colorado River is a big star here, pretty much the center, but there are some amazing hikes in the area, some of which I haven't done yet, but I did one called Cathedral Wash, right down the road from here. We're gonna probably be stopping for a different reason in that parking area, but such a beautiful area, as you can tell. It's just like a different planet. And there you go, folks, straight ahead, looking at you, those towering Vermilion Cliffs. Late afternoon sun, it's about 5 o'clock, sun setting about 7 o'clock out here. And I'm speaking in Arizona time, by the way. But yeah, just magnificent. Some of the best cliffs, most beautiful cliffs ever. And it's right about here that you get your first glimpse at the Colorado River as you drive back this way, but you quickly lose sight of it, then you'll see it again. I'm gonna just go down to one particular spot that I really like down here. One of the first rapids, or the first rapids, I think, after the popular boat launches where they launch all of the river rafting excursions into the Grand Canyon. So you're not gonna get to see anything in Lee's Ferry here, because really we're kind of at the start of it. It's gonna be down the road. Just wanted to come down here late afternoon, it's pleasant, and check out some of these rapids. Take in some of the cool air from the river, maybe dip my toe in, I don't know. And refresh myself after all this filming in the heat all day long. And I didn't have to walk far to get down here. Either the first or one of the first rapids downstream of Lee's Ferry, which is probably about a mile upstream, I estimate. Maybe not even that. Pretty calm rapids, I'd say. You could see like the deep green and blue of the Colorado over there, and this more muddy look here. And that's because another river, a very muddy river, flows into this, the confluence being right around the corner, called the Paria River. So you're actually seeing the mud from the Paria mixing into the Colorado, which I imagine is what we saw from the top of the bridge when I was saying we saw dirt. It's probably from tributaries flowing in here and bringing silt and mud in, I guess. And I showed this spot on a previous video, this little sandbar man-made. It looks like that heads out there. I just thought it's pretty quaint. And if you wanted to just sit out and wade, which I think I'm gonna do here. I'm gonna call it right here. This might be the most pleasant YouTubing experience of my career because of my feet right now. The coldness that I feel and how good it feels. I don't think I've ever appreciated coldness and coolness like this ever. Okay, we are going to part ways with the river now, and we're going to be heading now deeper into the Vermilion Cliffs. I'm actually staying, I haven't told you that yet or revealed it, but I'm actually staying in that area overnight. So we're going to get to explore a place that has a little bit of history on its own, but now we're going to make our way further west. You know, I admit I'm a little bummed actually leaving this particular area, because I've been filming here almost all day. As I've been alluding to this other Lee's Ferry episode, further upstream than we were just now. And I've fallen in love with this area, and it's really made me want to come back here and try out kayaking or boating or something. You can take, there are all sorts of kayak tours and services that will haul you up to the Glen Canyon Dam or downstream of the dam a little bit, and then you can float back, and there's different hour trips, 2 hour trips, 8 hour trips. You can camp overnight and first come, first serve camping sites over there. There's so much to explore, and we could get a little bit more adventurous on this channel, I think. So we're driving into the sun, but I think around this corner there may be a landmark, something cool to check out. And I saw it by the car earlier. And that's our next stop, actually. It's a really quick one, but really neat. And something very Southwest. Wow, you could feel like a really warm and hot breeze blowing out here right now. Very warm. But look at this. And not only this one, there's another one that I even like better, but it's smaller over here. Looks like a mushroom. I was reading about the meaning of this. How did this happen? This is very strange. I think this is, I don't know if the official name is the umbrella, but they refer to these as an umbrella, and I'll explain why. So this is a really interesting thing to talk about. So at some point, a giant boulder would have fallen, like many others you see strewn about this rock field here at the base of the cliffs. And there it would have sat for thousands of years. Think of all of, over the millennia, all of the storms and rain and erosion that would occur. But these rocks were protecting and shielding the layer below. So the layer below did not erode at the same rate as the stuff surrounding it. And now this thing is balanced, just like so. This actually makes me a little nervous, just on that small, like winning the lottery, mega lottery kind of chance that this thing would fall right now. Who knows, but let's study this up close. The impression the sign gave me was like, this is just dirt and stuff, but I don't think it is. It's really just a very compacted, I mean, it's rock. You know, if I play with it, I can't even pluck off any of it with my fingers. So it's not like flaky like you'd think. It's really hard as a rock. And you can really see though, I mean, you're probably dealing with two different types of material here. And I don't know the I forgot my earth science, but you know what I'm saying. You have to wonder, will any of these other ones become little mushroom rocks one day? You would think some of them have a very good chance. And they have to learn from the finest, though. From this perspective, looking through the viewfinder, the one on the right looks like E.T. I see either E.T. be good, or I see like a zombie. These things are impressing me more than I thought when I was driving by, because you don't really realize just the immense size, how large these things are. And it's just so random too. You don't see this that often. So it's definitely something you do a double take. I'll be honest with you though, walking under these things like this, it's a little nerve wracking when you understand what this is. There's nobody coming out and testing its structural integrity every day, like at an amusement park. And it's going to come down. I guarantee you that one day. But thankfully, it was not today. We live to film one more day. All right, back on the Vermilion Cliffs adventure, and I think you might get your first glimpse at some of the cliffs here soon. Been waiting for the sun to go down a little bit because we're really facing a bad direction right now. I could imagine the morning might be the better choice for seeing the Vermilion Cliffs. And that's my theory about tomorrow morning when we wake up and continue our journey. We've got a few more things to do, but we're gonna see the Vermilion Cliffs plenty, so don't worry. We're just getting warmed up here. The next stop that I wanna see here in 89A is right over here near the Navajo Bridge. Navajo Bridge, there's a plaque or a sign that mentions this next stop. It's an old lodge, not the one I'm staying at tonight, by the way, but it's called the Marble Canyon Lodge, and it was very important in the development of this area, and it was built in the 1920s. So being that it's right here and there's a gas station and I need gas, let's go check it out. I'm not sure if it's worth checking out, but we'll find out. You can actually see a plaque commemorating Lee Ferry here next to the Marble Lodge. This to me looks like probably what I would assume is the historic lodge. It looks old. It's a motel. The sign's really cool. I've driven by this a million times and I've never bothered to stop here. The reason why I wanted to stop here, and I may not have if I didn't read about it at the Navajo Bridge on one of the signs. This place really was instrumental in developing this area, especially around that time of building the bridge. This place, I think, was around and could house people and early travelers in this area. Imagine in the late 1920s driving through here on some old car. You didn't really have many places. Those adventures would be epic, unlike anything we know today. You couldn't drive as far or as fast. And places like this would be your salvation. I stayed at a nearby lodge, which we're driving towards, so you'll get to see plenty of that. But this place is quaint. I would stay here too. I could smell that old wood smell though, which I love. I mean, I guess I'm a dork, and I'm accepting and fine with that. But this whole trip, I've just really been given a new appreciation and for the old days, what it would have been like to travel. Probably a lot more exposed to the elements, the more mechanical failures of your vehicle. Everybody probably had to be kind of a mechanic to some extent back then. And then to come out to inhospitable places like this. You know, even in the 1920s, in a way, you might call our first road travelers, our road trippers, pioneers in a way. You know, because they had to pave the way for us to have more modern convenience and accessibility to these locations. So Marble Canyon Lodge, we salute you. We do. This is a beautiful sculpture. I love this thing. It's like a river rafter. This was made in 1994, but I love getting opportunities like this. It's a brave explorer. Beautiful. And the Vermilion Cliffs that I'm waiting to reveal to you. It's just waiting for the sun to go. But we are heading this way. That is our general direction. We're heading west. Ladies and gentlemen, this is really our first proper introduction with the Vermilion Cliffs, which you could see in the background. And when you see them in the right light, and this isn't horrible, horrible right now, it's doable, but I imagine in the morning, I've learning lessons as we film this episode, when the sun is behind us, that would be a spectacular sight. But it ain't bad right now. If I stand and face the other direction, you get some nice lighting. And if you kind of look out in the middle of this like field, you see a canyon, and that's where the Colorado River goes. And you can kind of see the sun on some of the edges of the canyon as it heads towards that way and then becomes known as the Grand Canyon. My geology and my knowledge of this are a little spotty, so forgive me if I misspeak, but I believe the cliffs here are a good example of part of the Escalante staircase. Just these plateaus that just kind of drop off, and then you go to the next one, and the Grand Canyon is the end of that. This is some kind of version of heaven, though, I would say, out here in northern Arizona, except for the cars driving by occasionally making noise. Let's start to head west towards my accommodations for the evening, where I believe they have a restaurant too, so I can actually get a hot meal and dinner. Really, that's the plan, is just to explore this area rather than just drive through it and not stop to admire it, take pictures, see it at different lights at sunset like now, or seeing it at sunrise, doing some of the things like seeing the bridge that we checked out in Lee's Ferry. You just wouldn't know all of this stuff is back there. And that's really why I want to make videos like this, is that the cliffs on their own are striking enough, but it's part of Arizona. It's a very recognizable side of it, especially for those of us that live here, but I don't know if the whole world is as familiar with this. So I want to just bring this to some of you. I think there are some ruins or something too, right around here. And I've never understood the meaning of them or what they are exactly. And I'm keeping an eye out because I want to pull over. They're like these stone structures, maybe early pioneer structures. I think they're right up here, in fact, right off the road. Or maybe it's just an old roadside attraction or tourist trap. Right next to where I'm staying at the Cliff Dwellers Lodge. And more balanced rocks, too.
It's one of the few times where I've driven through here, either to Kanab or to the north rim of the Grand Canyon. I've driven by this thing many times, always in a rush, never wanting to stop. and I never really paid attention that there are more of these balanced rocks out here. I really should have done some research to figure out what this was. I don't know. I'll try to find out when I go back to the hotel later. But it looks like maybe some kind of roadside attraction that once existed here. Not like this giant boulder, probably one of these like umbrella rock things with a building built around it. You can go inside of it, it looks like. You could tell they've done some renovation on it. This looks freshly painted, but the wood around here looks pretty old and rotted. And you've got those like beams. Who knows? Nothing left to do but to go inside, right? How strange. Yeah, it is one of these giant rocks. And they built like a shelter up against it. Looks like there are wooden beams in here too. What the heck was this thing? It's actually kind of fascinating. I love this thing, but I have no idea what it is. I did not do good research, folks. Can't think of everything every time, but look how that beam is bowed there in the middle. And then that giant rock, there's a pipe coming out of the top of it. Do they have running water here? Is that a clue? Looks like they have some cement and concrete on the top also. So what is this they actually built here? You can kind of see that, you know, famous looking bottom part of these things here. And you got this little window looking out that way to more balanced rocks. Or is that an arch-like thing? My guess is this is probably a relic from the 1920s or 30s or something like that. Once travelers came here with its proximity next to the road, and the fact that it's kind of this kooky thing where they built a structure around this thing, maybe like an old convenience store or roadside attraction. It's my best guess. So this is man-made, like out of plaster or something, so I don't really know what the heck this is. 2022, 2020, I'm looking for graffiti from a different time, and that is not to be found here, but there's that giant boulder that serves as partially the roof of this thing, and you could see there's different, more modern looking cement material. So someone's taking care of this, which I don't know if that's a good or bad thing. I just thought this would be a quick thing, like, oh, there's this little rock building, and I just didn't remember it now until now, but this is so neat. This is definitely a worthy stop here on the Vermilion Cliffs Route 89 road trip. And this, some interesting graffiti that's hard for me to read, but I think it's from May 15th, 1949. And based on the penmanship of the letters, it does seem like something from a different time. Some cool patterns too. So May 15th of 49, someone carved this here. Max Parman, Lois something, and I don't know, whatever. You're about to become historical graffiti one day, folks. You're getting there. And then I assume bullet holes. This has been an amazing journey, and I really didn't even realize how much there is to do and see, and I just scratched the surface. Absolutely beauty and splendor as far as the eye can see.